So what did you talk about West Bank? Who were in mind?
Christopher Columbus.
Yeah, who was the one?
Christopher Columbus.
Christopher Columbus.
Columbus Exchange.
Columbus Exchange. Don't think about his grave, that might be on your first quiz, which I will give you next week. Check the announcement section. Maybe this Thursday. So be ready to vote. The first quiz might be this Thursday or next week. Anyway, Columbus, geographical discoveries, invasion of Europeans of the so-called New World. Okay, we also researched what triggered European expansion. Okay. Remember, I told you some of my talks on YouTube, and I gave you this link. If I didn't, remind me that I didn't. Did I do it or I didn't?
No,
so I have to do it. Yeah, I'm sorry. But some of the lectures have been updated, so that is why I taped them in you in order to put them to replace the old ones. Okay. So try to be here if you can. Okay. So, do you remember what we talked at the very end of the last conversation?
The Spanish administration in the New World. Uh-huh. That was the last thing we talked about.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
There was a lack of workers in the new Spanish, like the Spanish American Empire, because they would flee or they would die due to the disease. So they looked elsewhere, which was West Africa.
Absolutely correct, yeah. I'm glad that both of you brought it up. In fact, I encourage you to put these two responses together, because you mentioned the so-called Spanish system they created in the Latin America, which they named Encomienda, okay? In if you kind of replace this word with the good old word feudalism, that's what it was all about. An attempt to make Native Americans into peasants, okay, and made them work for Spanish conquistadors. You can see, you still can see this word, which wasn't erased, okay? So don't forget about this word, which is not in PowerPoints, conquistadors, okay? So, and they hoped they would be masters and Native Americans would be working for them, but again, now we need your response, so please make sure that you remember what happened, okay? So, Indians or indigenous people, Native Americans, depending which expression you prefer to describe the Native people of North and South America, they were dying from epidemic diseases. That was the major thing, remember? And also, I might pose a question on the quiz, the common quiz, what was the greatest killer of the Native Americans, and I will confuse you with the questions. I will give you options like European guns, something else, and of course, a lot of students put this European guns, which wasn't the case, because some of the Native Americans, they had died before they saw so-called white men. Okay, I said so-called Europeans. There was a bunch of different people who streamed to the New World. Okay. So, the major killer of the Native Americans was diseases, European diseases. So, for this reason, there were hardly any workers. Okay? And the problem was where to find workers. Remember, like two or three times at the end of the last class, I asked you this question. I kind of posed this rhetorical question. And you correctly answered right now that yes, Africa became the source of labor, and not the entire Africa, but particularly area of Africa. Remember, I even asked you a question, so what particular part of Africa? And together we figured out it was Western Africa, because it was the closest location to South America. The so-called, later became known as so-called Narrow Passage. Okay, 2 weeks travel from West Africa to South America with a cargo of slaves. Okay. That's how it was done. Okay. So today we're going to talk about transatlantic slave trade, but to be honest, it's a little bit confusing title, because today I'm not only going to discuss so-called transatlantic slave trade. I will put, since we're doing world history, I will put transatlantic slave trade in the context of world history, in the context of world slavery, okay, to make sure that we don't lose the track of what was going on in other parts of the world, okay, because we don't want to be provincial, because people have tendency to amplify the history of the area where they live, the country where they live, okay? For example, if you live in Israel or in Russia, of course, they emphasize what happened there and the problems, good things. Since we live in the United States, sometimes when you hear the word slavery, oh, it's American South, it's, that's it, that's the story. You don't see beyond this American provincialism, you know? So the goal of the world history is kind of contextualize the stuff we're discussing, okay? So that's what we will be doing today, okay? So it's not only a story about transatlantic slave trade, it's about the slave trade in the modern world, in the early modern world at that time, okay? Okay, so here I'm going to repeat what you told us, okay? So Spain found a lot of gold and silver in the New World, okay? And the gold and silver were pretty much extracted from the New World by the 1600s. And that's when the slave trade reached its peak in the 1600s, when gold and silver deposits were exhausted and European colonizers were thinking about how to utilize this land since the labor was not available. So we need to use this land. So again, Native American labor was not there. Okay. And the European colonizers, Spaniards and Portuguese, they found a way to use this land. Okay. They found that sugar cane could be grown in tropical areas of Latin America. Caribbean Islands, Brazil, present-day Colombia, Venezuela, okay. This is Central America, present-day states, Nicaragua, Panama. At that time, of course, they didn't exist. All these areas were Spanish or Portuguese colonies. So they started to grow sugar cane. But again, they needed labor. They used this land. For sugar cane became a good supplement or replacement for extracted gold and silver. Okay. Now the problem was to get the land. And that's how they gradually started going to Western Africa and buying slaves, not abducting people. Because again, another stereotype is that some people think that Europeans, Portuguese, or Spaniards, they came to the Western African coast and abducted the Africans and enslaved them. No, it wasn't done this way. In fact, they were afraid to get in inland Africa. Europeans at that time were afraid to get into tropical Africa. Okay. Do you know why? Any guesses why Europeans were afraid to get?
Climate.
It was called at that time white man's ranger, because at that time they still did not invent medicine to treat yellow fever, to alleviate tropical diseases. So Europeans died like flies if they stayed in tropical areas of Africa, like 1-2 months and you're gone. But local people have immunity for this disease. Again, it's about immunity, okay? So what these European slave traders did, they approached the Western African coast, where, by the way, Portuguese already had set up supply stations. Remember what we talked about last time, about Portuguese were trying to reach out to India, spices, remember? But forget about the spices, that's what I should ask in terms of reviewing the last class. Spices, that's what had triggered European expansion. So Portuguese already established supply stations in West Africa in order to sail around the north or south most part of Africa and through the Indian Ocean to reach the source of spices. And now these supply stations were refurbished into slave stations. So Portuguese and later Spaniards, it out, or to destroy some of these stations. They approached local African kings and queens and purchased slaves from them. Okay, that's how it was done. So local African kings and queens, they brought slaves to the coast and sold them to the Europeans. Okay. In some books they say the slave trade started in 1518 or another year is provided. But all these dates superficial. Suppose in 1518 some Spanish merchant reached the Western African coast. The local African king didn't have any gold to pay him for European goods, and he offered slaves, and he received this payment, 100 plus something slaves, and brought these slaves later to Cuba, and that's how it started. This is just a legend, because there were probably many cases like this. So the only thing we can say, it started in early 1500s, the slave trade. But at first, it was not widespread, because the Native Americans were still there. But by the end of the 1500s, the slave trade, transatlantic slave trade, extended because the needs for labor were growing. Okay. At first, it was Portuguese and Spaniards. These were the people who controlled the slave trade across the Atlantic. Later, the English and the Dutch joined. Okay. So, next time. Or today, if we have time, check this out. You will learn later in this course that the Dutch and the English were able to squeeze the Spaniards and Portuguese from the international trade, because the Dutch and the English, they were more enterprising people. They were able to exercise more engineers in terms of inventions, in terms of art, in terms of technology. But just to let you know what happened, Spain and Portugal, they were kind of spoiled with riches. Okay, the manufacturing died in these countries. So eventually, the English and the Dutch, they were able to step in and seize these trade routes, including the slave routes, including some colonies, Spanish and Portuguese colonies, island colonies, and Caribbean islands. Okay. So at first Portugal, then Spain, then Dutch, English joined this slave trade. Okay, so, okay, but the question is, okay, everything's clear. The last bullet point explains to you why it was not Europeans who had been brought to the New World to work as slaves. Okay. At first, of course, it was Europeans. A lot of them were indentured servants. It means the people who received a free passage to the New World, but in exchange they were obligated to work by 10, 15 years, sometimes 20 years for their masters. Okay. But many of them died quickly because they couldn't work on shoes one day. They had no immunity to talk to diseases. So and soon this project was known. Plus it was hard to get these European slaves. Okay. The major slave market, you will see where it was. It was the Black Sea, the northern coast of Africa, where Arab pirates or Berber pirates, they controlled the slave trade in Europeans. Okay. So, but it was dangerous and expensive to go there, to deal with pirates. Okay. So for climate reasons, or genetic reasons, as I said, the European slaves and indentured servants didn't have immunity for tropical diseases, and plus it was hard to deal with errant pirates or Black Sea slave trade because it was too expensive to bring slaves from there. It was easy to go to Western Africa, it was closest there. So, just in general, Atlantic slave trade continued for 400 years, 1500s to roughly 1870s, and by the end of the 19th century, it dwindled down. The last country to abolished slavery was Cuba, by the way. Cuba and Brazil. Brazil, I think, did it in 1884, Cuba in 1885. But you probably heard that in some countries, slavery existed until recently in African country. Mali, West African country, by the way, it existed until 1980. It also existed in Yemen, that's a country near Saudi Arabia, until 1962. Different numbers are provided to us about the number of slaves who were shipped from Western Africa to the New World. I'm sorry. So some historians say that it was 12 million. Most in textbooks you will see 12 million. Okay. Others say, yes, it was about 12 million, 11.8, but many of them died. And out of this, about 9 plus something millions actually were brought to the New World, because the others died on the way. Okay. There was a mortality rate, large mortality rate. And most slaves arrived to the New World between these 2 days, 1700 and 1810. Why 1810? It's also important to know. Because in 1807, you have to remember this day, the first country in the world, it was England, that abolished the slave trade. Abolished in earnest. Why did I make this remark in earnest? Because there were two other countries that tried to abolish slavery. France tried to do it in 1791, French Revolution. But they didn't hold to the promise. And Napoleon later instituted the whole. And the number is very important. And there was also attempt to abolish slave trade by Netherlands. But they didn't stick to the system. So it was only in England where they were able to abolish slave trade. Not slavery, but slave trade. So that is why after 1807 or to this 1810, slavery started to die gradually, not right away. There is also a misconception, especially people who live in the United States, they think that most of the slaves from West Africa were brought to the United States, to Southern United States. It's absolutely wrong. It wasn't the case. Only tiny minority of slaves shipped from Western Africa were brought here to the so-called Southern States, Florida, Louisiana. Out of this number, see, only about 600,000 were brought to North America, southern part of North America, and only few to Central Atlantic States. Only few. Okay, here this map, look at this map, it shows you the numbers. See, the majority of slaves, where did they go? Brazil and Caribbean islands, so-called West Indies, Cuba, Jamaica, Haiti, Hispaniola, and only 4% went to so-called British North America. So please remember this, it's also important for us. Okay. That is why if you go to present-day Brazil, Cuba, or especially Jamaica, you will see the racial face of these countries, almost all of them black, because by the 1600s, all Indians, Native Americans were gone. White people were afraid to live there. So that is why these areas became populated by Africans. Okay? That's how it was a huge, tremendous racial change. Again, now, as I told you in the beginning of this lecture, we are going to contextualize our conversation about transatlantic slavery. We need to remember that slavery was not invented in the 15th and 1600s, when the Portugal and Spain started to trade with people between West Africa and Latin America. No. It had existed before, since ancient times, if you took the first part of world history, those of you here or at school, you probably learned about slavery had existed in Egypt, you know, ancient Greece and Rome, in Africa. So, slavery definitely existed, had existed in Western Africa. What happened in the 1500s? These Europeans who came to trade in people, they simply plugged into this trade and rerouted it. Rerouted it to the New World, okay? That's what happened. So before the 1500s, slave trade was conducted through Sahara Desert, okay? European slaves from here, African slaves from here, gold, salt, and slaves. Going back and forth, okay? Let's move on. Slave trade also existed in the eastern part of Africa and the Middle East, or Near East. Okay. And Arab merchants were in charge of this trade. Unfortunately, we don't have exact numbers about this trade here. Arab Springs, Arabs approached East Coast, only Arabs and purchased people abducted from Ethiopia. Why Ethiopia? Because Ethiopia was a Christian kingdom, okay? And nearby people were all converted to Islam, except Central Africa, where people were remaining pagan. But in these areas, a lot of people were Muslims, and according to Islam, you cannot enslave your own, okay? So that is why Ethiopia, the only African Christian country at that time, because it was the country that avoided this invasion of Islam. Remember, Islam was a late bloomer in 1700s. Islam extended from Arabia to modern Africa, Middle East, and dislodged Christians and the Ethiopian Christian kingdom, which was a current kingdom, hiding in the mountains. So anyway, these Christians were an easy prey for this Arab slave merchants. So they were called Nubians occasionally. They were abducted and sold into slavery. That's how it was done. Unfortunately, unlike European merchants, Arab slave merchants, they didn't keep record of their human cargo. So that is why it's hard for us today to explore these slave trade. Okay? That is why so much attention is paid to transatlantic slave trade, because it's very well documented. It's very well documented, unlike Arab slave trade. There was also Ottoman slave trade, another source. Okay. So African slave trade, Arab slave trade, Indian Ocean, eastern coast of Africa. Now Ottoman slave trade. Okay, I'm showing you the hubs, the major hubs of the slave trade in the early modern world. Okay. Oh, it's a picture, like 1853, it's a painting that depicts this a trade of a woman is traded. Okay. The major hub of Ottoman slave trade was Black Sea area, particularly Crimean Peninsula. Crimean Peninsula, there was a town of Kaffa. Okay. That was like a transitional station which was used to ship the slaves from where? From Eastern Europe, Ottoman slave merchants raided these areas for dealt with local kings, purchasing people and back from Slavic lands. By the way, the word Slavic originated from the word slave, okay, Slavic slave. Okay. It was one of the major sources of slaves before the New World was discovered. When they lived in the West Africa. So before the 1500s, it was this particular area that provided a lot of slaves for European towns, for Ottomans, because these Slavic lands, they were preyed upon by slave merchants. Ottoman Turks, Ottoman Empire was one of the most powerful empires. We're going to talk about it. We will be, in 2 weeks, I think, we will have a special lecture on Ottoman Empire. Remember, that was the empire that blocked trade in spices, okay? Charging this
cute exuberant prices from Ginger, Cinnamon, and Pepper, which brought the New Orleans to find Sierra, so these Ottomans, not only they control the trade in spices, but they also control the trade in slaves. Okay. And another thing, to make my story kind of complete, because what I'm doing, I'm complicating the picture. Remember, I told you, history is not black and white. It's a 60 shades of gray. I always keep reminding my students. So slavery had existed in the New World among so-called Indians or indigenous people, Native Americans. Okay? And of course, when you mention up front to some kind of Native American, they might not like it. They say, oh, we will know, because every group wants to know. So we are best, we are the best. Okay, if you go to Russians, they will tell you, oh, we are so noble, and we are the best. But again, slavery had practice. We're in South America and North America. Since we live in North America, so let me tell you about North America. Okay? So prior to the European invasion of North America, slavery was used as auxiliary labor and hostages were. Here in this area where we live, among Creek Indians, the Muscogee Indians, Chickasaw, and later it was enhanced by European slaveholders, okay? But indigenous, die-hard indigenous slavery had flourished on the northwestern coast of North America, okay? Very important economically it was for local societies, okay? Northwest coast of North America. Here, because of the abundant sources of fish, okay, wood, and all the plentiful resources, local Native American groups became very rich. Okay, so they were buying slaves, organized raids, capturing slaves. Okay. So here we are talking about the Northwest Coast Indians. Okay, that's the area. So two kind of, if you know geography well, just think about westernmost part of Canada and southeastern Alaska and northwesternmost part of the United States. It's northwest coast of North America, okay? So you probably saw this totem poles, right? Totem poles, like this craftsmanship of local Native Americans. So these were these slave societies that produced these pieces of art, okay? Because they could afford having a lot of craftsmen. Because slaves were performing regular jobs for maybe like fishing, hunting, you know, so there was a chance for them, unlike other Native American societies, to keep people who could enjoy leisure, unlike other Native American groups, which were equal. So again, Native American societies were different. Some of them had slavery, some of them didn't have slavery. Okay? That's what I'm trying to tell you. Here in this area, northwest coast of North America, slavery was very important. Okay. Tlingit, Haida, Salish people, and slaves were not only used to do regular work, it was a prestige. A chief was to be accompanied by slaves, okay, like retinue of slaves, to be cool. Okay. During giveaway potlatch ceremonies, potlatch, you heard about potlatch? It's like a communal feast among Northwest Coast Indians where the chiefs try to outdo each other, showing off, you know, I'm rich and I can burn blankets, I can burn supplies of fish, I can kill slaves. And another says, no, no, I'm richer than you, so I can kill plenty of slaves, you kill them with pencil. So just showing off. I don't care about riches, okay? That's interesting society. So they, during the ceremonies, give away potlatch ceremonies, they ritually slaughter the slaves. Okay. But by the way, even when United States purchased Alaska, Alaska was a colony of Russia, in 1867, slavery continued to exist
after 1867, the man local think it English. I always like to trick my students with this question. Where was the last slave released on the territory? You know, probably in Texas, June 19th, or this new holiday. Also, the smartest students tell, no, Mr. Z, you know, the last slave was liberated in Oklahoma, again, because there was an Indian nation, Creek Indian nation, who didn't want to release their black slaves by isolation 66. And American troops had to come and force them. I said, I appreciate it. Yeah, that was true, you know. There were some Native Americans in here in the South, you know, who refused to do it, and they had to be pressured by the U.S. government to do it. I said, but still, you are wrong. I appreciate your fact, which is true. But the last slave was released in 1910, okay, by a slave chief who was holding in bondage an old slave, and he was already crippled, handicapped, old, and he released him to the joy of local U.S. Marshal. It was registered in 1910, okay? 1910. The last slave, okay, at least recorded. Case. Maybe there were some slaves we don't know about somewhere in the woods and in the mountains. Okay. By the way, among Salish Indians, noble people, slaveholders, aristocrats, to differentiate themselves, to set themselves apart from slaves, okay, they deformed their heads. You know, when the noble kings were born, they would put this wooden plate, plaque on this and that. The skull was deformed of this king. Okay? So in the later, it was considered a sign of beauty, you know, deformed skull. Regular skull wasn't beautiful. So, again, the beauty, standards of beauty are very relevant. Each civilization, each group has its own standards of beauty, right? Whether we like it or not. So it was cool, beautiful, and nice, and status symbol to have your skull deformed, it showed your status. Okay? That is why slaves had regular skulls. See, we see this class difference. Just to tell you how things have been done here in the New World. Okay, so now you know the picture. The picture was not as black and white, as I said, but more complicated. Let's go back to transatlantic slavery. Okay. Indeed, when Europeans, Portugal and Spain rerouted slave trade routes from Africa to the New World. That became the major slave market. Okay. 12 million people shipped from West Africa to the New World. It wasn't big deal. Okay. All these hubs of slave trade, which I mentioned, of course, they couldn't be huge. Enterprise. 12 million people. It was the huge demographic population movement in the world history in transatlantic slave trade. Transatlantic slave trade also became part of so-called triangular trade. Okay. It was considered part of the triangular trade. It's a trading network that was established between the new and old world. Okay. And connected these three continents, Europe, Americas, and Africa. Well, let me show you the map, and you will see. Okay. See, that's how it was done. It shows you some products, goods, humans delivered, exchanged, traded, okay. See, that's what, how it was done. So slaves that were delivered from Africa to here were part of this trade because sugar cane worked by slaves was turned into work. And molasses, it's this maple syrup looking like liquid, right? That was used to produce alcohol, okay, or used as a substitute for sugar. Okay. Other goods also were exchanged. From Europe, manufactured goods were delivered here. Okay. Sometimes slaves were exchanged for manufactured goods. All right, I mentioned this is just, again, for information that's of the format of this trade that was conducted between West Africa and the New World was done in this way, when local kings and chiefs delivered slaves to the coastal areas and Europeans were purchasing these slaves. So Europeans did incentivize local African, did incentivize local African kings and chiefs to go to organize military expeditions against alien tribes and put them in bondage and sell them to the Europeans. Okay. Middle Passage, again, I remember I mentioned this. Middle Passage, the kind of the best shortcut, the best route. West Africa to Brazil, 2 weeks. And the most popular route, which also became notorious because a lot of people died, because some were doing the shortcuts, some slave merchants, they didn't bring enough supplies. Some people died en route, so it was the death rate during the narrow passage travel was very high, because the expectation was soon, quickly, they would cross this Atlantic Ocean area. So close. So those who had to travel to Cuba, to Florida, of course, they had to provide themselves with a lot of supply of food, making sure that they would make it. But during the narrow passage around, a lot of slave merchants, they cut a lot of corners. Okay, that's it. Cut a lot of corners. High mortality rate. I'm going to jump ahead, so we're still talking chronologically, we're still talking about 1500s, 1600s, but I'm going to jump ahead in the 1700s, okay, because I want you to know that kind of the whole story of this transatlantic slave trade, so let me jump a little bit ahead. As I said, Great Britain becomes the first country to shut down Atlantic slave trade, and it happened in 1807, so please remember this date, it's important for us. And she became the first country to abolish slavery completely in 1830, earlier than other countries. Okay. So England was a pioneer in many respects. And England, in fact, assigned a military fleet to patrol the western coast of Africa to arrest the boats, slave boats, slave ships, arrest them, confiscate them. And in fact, the English government provided the captains and crews of their military people special monetary bonuses. The more slave boats they would catch, the higher their bonuses would be. Of course, it worked, but of course, people trying to be zealous, and a lot of regular boats suffered. So sometimes regular boats were confiscated and things like slave boats. Human beings are humans. They, when they incentivize, you know, they try to invent ways to make more money. Okay. So there were a lot of complaints at that time to avoid fighting against slave merchants, sometimes regular boats were confiscated. But again, we have to admit that England was the pioneer here, okay, and it helped England to expand her empire.
because England presented herself in Africa as the delivery. Okay. That's how, for instance, later southernmost part of Africa was grabbed by England, because they built themselves as liberators of slaves. Okay. So local Europeans and local African elites couldn't compete with them. Because okay. Some Africans were joining English against local African chiefs or against Europeans who still maintained slavery. Okay. So it did help England. Ironically, I have something uncomfortable for England during, during the Civil War. Ironically, England didn't support Northern States. England supported Confederacy. That's an irony of the situation. Do you know why? Because England was afraid that United States getting rid of slavery would become a powerful industrial nation. It would compete with Britain, because Britain was the main industrial nation. They didn't want Confederacy. For the reasons of war, because of this competition, they decided to help the Federalists. The most progressive nation decided to help the Federalists with guns, with ammunition. See, that's, again, I'm complicating the picture purposely, telling you that history is not black and white. History is six shades of gray. Again, the third time I'm reminding you. Anyway, U.S. Congress outlawed slave trade. Not slavery, but slave trade. 1808, it did help also to shut down transatlantic slavery. When we have two countries, England and the United States, shutting down slave trade. By the way, that's why after this, the price of slaves dramatically increased in the southern United States, because it was hard to bring slaves from West America since the trade was shut down. But Spain, Portugal, and African states that profited from slave trade, they refused to shut down slave trade. So it became like a tug of war, mostly between England and the other European nations, and local African kingdoms who profited from this trade. So there might be some useful information here. I encourage you to write it down as much as possible. Okay. Let's move on. Okay. That's a bill that was adopted by the English Parliament. As I said, England became the first country to go against slavery in the 1700s. Why did England go? Okay. For various reasons. For practical reasons, and for moral reasons, and for economic reasons. Okay, well, let me bring this up. Moral reasons. There were Christians in England, especially Methodist Church, that in England, I repeat, in England, Methodist Church was against slavery. And especially this guy, William Wilberforce. Here's his picture. William Wilberforce, he was like the major spearhead. A Methodist minister who published about the evils of slavery, that it was against the Bible. Ironically, in southern United States, Bible was used to justify slavery. The Bible is very contradictory. Agnostic inside of myself. Bible can be interpreted in a different ways. You can't justify anything by using Bible, to be honest. Because there's so many contradictory statements there, to be honest. I don't want to offend religious folks, of course. But William Wilberforce quoted the passages from Bible that condemn slavery. Okay. It's against Christian principles, well, human beings, okay? It's against our human morality. See the statement, look at his statement, I quoted him. God Almighty has set before me two great objects, the suppression of the slave trade and the reformation of manners. So it was part of reforming human beings, making them better. So that was the goal.
The first goal. The second goal was economic. There were English thinkers, and here you can see a picture of the most popular of them, who was crusading along with Wilberforce against slavery. He was crusading against slavery. Adam Smith. Did anybody hear this name? In a different context, yeah?
But yeah, like microeconomics.
Exactly right. He became a famous economist. And then in fact, we are not going to say goodbye to him by discussing him today. We will meet him again in a couple of weeks when we are going to discuss so-called enlightenment. Okay? You're absolutely right. So he was the author of the famous book, which you still can find in bookstores, if we have bookstores. If they survive, you can go to the bookstore and look at the shelf of paperbacks, at least before this corona hysteria. I went to the bookstore 2019, and I did see his book and paperback, The Wealth of Nations. The Wealth of Nations. Okay. Like you said, it's a set of economic ideas. Okay. That says that government should stay away from economics. Okay. People should be free to work wherever they want. People should be free to set up their own businesses. People should be free to prosper. People should be free to get broke. People should be free to be hired. People should be free to be fired. So basically a gospel of free market. Okay. So that is why in the present day, people who advocate ideas of free market, they hold in the highest esteem. So, although he was a professor of moral philosophy at Edinburgh University, he became famous not for his moral teaching, but for his economic ideas. Okay, that was his main contribution. Okay. And basically he said that slavery is more costly than free labor. Okay, and he was right, of course. Nobody's going to work for free. If you force people to work for free, they are not going to produce anything. They're going to break the tools, they're going to escape, whatever. Okay, you will not raise productive workers when you force people to work for free. Pay them. That's how the labor will be efficient. See, he approached the same topic of slavery, not only from moral positions, it was wrong, because certain Christian ideas, but from economic viewpoint. Okay? He said it was costly, it was not profitable. In the long run, you will lose. You might make instant profit right now, right here, but in the long run, you will lose. And he, by the way, compared two areas in North America. At that time, it was British America. He said, look at the southern part of British North America. Look at the northern part of British North America. The southern part is very backward, economically backward. There aren't any industry. Okay? There are no factories there. Okay? No spirit of enterprise. But look at the northern colonies of Britain, like New York, Maine, Vermont, New Hampshire. You will see that the industries based on free labor, they're prospering. Okay, that's what he tried to explain. So his conclusion was simple: slavery retards your economy. Okay? And if you don't understand this, he kind of appealed to kings, queens, heads of state. If you don't understand this, you're a fool. You're shooting yourself in the foot. Okay? That's a very powerful argument. Okay. And of course, as I mentioned earlier, there was a third reason why slavery, anti-slavery agenda helped Britain. Okay, Britain positioned herself as their leader. Okay, it helped her to win the sympathies of colonial people. Okay? Very good, because that's how England was able to outdo Spain, Portugal, and some African slave-based kingdoms. Okay. So three major reasons. So remember this name, very important name, Adam Smith. We will meet him again. Okay. Okay, that's it. So now I'm kind of, I don't know why, I forgot to deliver this letter. So remember, the last conversation, last time, we had the slide, okay? And now we're going back where we started last time in the beginning. So that was the origin of the transatlantic slave trade, okay? And that's something you might want to remember for your quiz. Go ahead. The third reason, it's a colonial reason. So it helped England to expand, okay? Because they said, we are sending you free, unlike the investors like Spain is working with all local African teams who want to enslave. That is why some Africans sympathize with it. Because by the English American, which is rarely mentioned in textbooks, by the way. Okay, because again, it's, people want to see history as black and white. We can condemn some kind of nation or slavery. Oh, look at everything. They're so bad, everything's bad. We're not going to. We're going to cheer people. We're not going to mention other things. We don't feed the nets. So avoid this. Avoid this if you. History, I read it. Always, it depends from what angle you look at. There were a lot of comfortable, uncomfortable facts. Okay, so the story of slave trade, which I mentioned, is over. But what I want to bring to your attention to finish the story is that Spain and Portugal. So oh, hold on, so sit still. Don't jump. The story about European expansion overseas with the New World doesn't finish where we finished right now, because we talked about Spain and Portugal, we talked about slave trade, but we didn't talk too much about the competition among European groups. Okay. Eventually, we had two groups of Europeans who started to fight over the domination of the world, especially the Americans. And these two groups were Spain and Portugal on the one side, Catholic countries, and Netherlands or the Dutch and England on the other side, of course. The reason I'm going to bring up this right now, because next time we are going to talk about Protestant Reformation. That is why I pulled out the syllabus to say Protestant Reformation. Next time will be a story about how Europe became split religiously in two groups, competition sense. Southern Europe remained Catholic, Northern Europe split away, okay, and left the Catholic Church. And they became known as Protestants. And eventually they started to fight with each other. They were fighting about religion, and they were fighting also about economic dimension. Very important to mention this, okay? Because eventually, and I'm jumping again, Protestant cardinals, they were able to win. Win, because they were more enterprising for different reasons. And for religious reasons too. Next time we will find out why this English and the Dutch people who were in the Netherlands, they were more enterprising than Spaniards. They were able to unleash their economies, unlike Spain and Portugal, which were spoiled with riches, which destroyed the manufacturing, which didn't encourage economic growth. For religious reasons, which I'm not going to detail right now, the English and the Dutch, they were able to give more economic freedom to their people because of the Protestant, unlike Catholic religion, where misery, financial activity, one of them. So you'll find out about this next time. To make a long story short, that Holland, Protestant nation, became a merchant republic, where merchants were held in the highest level. England, which was still a kingdom, still gave a lot of freedoms for entrepreneurs and merchants. Holland gave right to vote to her people. Holland and England introduced religious toleration. all religions were tolerated, except Catholics. Spain and Portugal, they were discriminating against the Jews. A lot of Jews escaped to Netherlands and to England. The most enterprising people who were financially capable, they formed a lot of jobs which were not performed by regular Catholics, for instance, who looked down upon financial people. So Northern Europe became more advanced. Limited monarchy in England also was very helpful. England and Holland originally were more interested in trade with colonial people, not in extracting the riches, robbing them. Okay. In North America, for instance, Britain at first, especially in the 1600s, mostly traded with Native Americans. Later they started to seize the land, and that's how Indian European wars started. But originally it was about trade. The entire country of Canada raised this Hudson Bay Company colony. They trade monopoly, but traded with Indians. Unlike Spain and Portugal, which had conquistadors which wanted to turn indigenous people into serfs, remember, they came in. Just to give you an idea, so Dutch and English colonizers in the New World, they were interested in trade and fiction. It's a visual, it's the best to comprehend. Trade and later working on the land. So English and the Dutch colonizers, they came by families later. Men and women, unlike Spanish conquistadors who were mostly males or who came to the New World and married Native American women. By the way, that's why in North America later we had more separation among Indians and Europeans than in South America. Because Europeans came by talent. Spain in the New World was interested, I repeat, in serfing Indians, making them into serfs. Again, these pictures show you conquistadors seizing these huge land estates, haciendas, where they tried to make Indians work, which didn't work out on many occasions as well. Again, just to compare and contrast. In the 1600s, when Spain and Portugal tried to make Indians into serfs, in North America, they tried to trade with Indians. So since there was no gold and silver discovered at that time in North America, the major asset was furs, pelts, beaver pelts, deer skins, and all this stuff. So that's why they traded with Indians, and of course, at this point, colonizers were not interested in destroying their customers. They wanted their customers. Hudson Bay Company, Canada, hardly had any wars with Indians because the Indians were treated as customers of the Hudson Bay Company. Of course, a lot of Indians got in debt. It's another issue. Kitchen 1600s, we're talking about these centuries. Eventually, since economical and social, Netherlands and England were becoming more powerful, more enterprising. Spain was very jealous. Spain became very hateful of them. For religious reasons and for economic reasons. A lot of Spanish conquistadors got in debt. They owed money, by the way, to English manufacturers. In fact, some slave routes eventually were seized by the British slave merchants. Okay. Because Spain had so much gold, they were not producing boats, not producing guns. They were purchasing them. So manufacturing died in Spain and Portugal. Like countries, unfortunately, those countries were losing manufacturing,
they become dependent on other nations. We might be able to essentially dependent on another nation. You can't be the biggest country in the world, almost lost to be section. Anyway, it's another story.
You think that could happen in America?
Yeah, it's just happening.
Yeah.
So we depend on China. China is an infection hub, and we are receiving it. I'm not going to talk more about it because it's a more recent. At the end of the semester, we might talk about it. But I'm just telling you what happens when you lose your manufacturing. You become dependent on another nation or another country that becomes the hub of manufacturing. At that time, manufacturing hub was Netherlands and England. So, plus, Netherlands originally was a part of Spain. Okay. And the Netherlands didn't want to be part of Spain, so there was a revolt, secession. Okay, Netherlands that were preyed on by the Spaniards, they revolted against Spaniards. Okay, in the 1500s, there was a long war, war of secession. The Netherlands seceded from Spain, and they were the first to come up with the slogan, no taxation without representation. The Americans wanted to pick it up because Netherlands said that we are going to be part of you if you give us a presentation, a parliament. And the Spanish king said, what are you talking about? I am the state. No parliament. That's how the clash started. Eventually, Netherlands, the Dutch, was supported by England, and Spain decided to finish them. And it happened in 1588, so this date I want you to remember, to write it down, 1588. Landmark date, when Spain finally had enough. These rotten English people, they called English the nation of shopkeepers. Okay. Because in English, English people encourage economic activity, so the Dutch did the same. But since England stood behind the Dutch, small nation, so Spain was mad at England, was the major supporter of the Dutch. In 1588, the Spanish king Philip organized a huge military fleet called Spanish Armada. Armada is something big, huge. Spanish Armada, more than 300 boats, military boats, and sent them against England and the Netherlands. Okay. But the English Queen Elizabeth was able to mobilize her population, merchants, pirates, everybody. The Dutch came, so everybody was on alert. And plus, the winds were very unfavorable for the Spanish fleet. And again, to make a long story short, the English and the Dutch smashed the English fleet, destroyed it. So Spain was losing not only economically, but militarily. Spain was defeating the Catholic country. That considered herself the shield of Catholic religion, Catholic Christianity, was defeated by two groups of nations, Netherlands, the Dutch, and the English, in the year 1588. Why is it so important? Because after this day, Spanish Empire slowly started to decline. Okay. So don't forget about this. And on the other hand, the Star of England and the Dutch started to rise up. And the English, by the 1700s, became the biggest colonial empire in the world, or the mightiest fleet, because of this economic, spirit of economic enterprise they encouraged, this anti-slavery agenda, all these niceties that helped them to establish their power all over the world. Okay. So, that's where our story will finish. Okay.